Mr. President, Honorable Ministers, distinguished delegates, I'd like to thank the Secretary General of the WHO to have given us the honor to participate in this solemn assembly and to talk on the topic of climate change. Climate change is a global phenomenon that poses unique challenges to the human health. And human health and the health of the environment are intimately connected in a very complex system of interdependence. Both are necessary to satisfy basic human needs. Unfortunately, both human health and the environment are under greater pressure than ever before. Southeast Asian states have largely addressed the issue of transboundary haze through collaboration at the regional level through the Association of Southeast Asian Nations of ASEAN. With significant progress. Initiatives at ASEAN level to address the transboundary haze pollution started in 2002 with the signing of the ASEAN Transboundary Haze Pollution Agreement in Kuala by 10 ASEAN member countries. However, the region's transboundary haze pollution problem is ultimately driven by policies and levels of commitments shown by individual countries within the region. Economic growth and flourishing domestic and international trade have also contributed in increasing consumption and pollution of water resources, as well as increasing CO2 emissions. Pollutants of industrial origins are also a huge problem in different parts of the world, with undocumented impacts on human health and the climate. There is a possibility of an El Nino phenomenon in the Southeast Asian region, and it may influence the climate in Malaysia. The phenomenon may inevitably lead to a dry spell in the Southeast Asian region in the later part of this year. This phenomenon may also increase the risk of vector-borne diseases such as dengue and malaria. Climate and temperature influences the vector population and behavior, including the virus replication. Various studies have shown that the incubation period of the virus reduces in warm temperature, as demonstrated in the laboratory experiments, which reduced from 12 days at 30 degrees centigrade to 7 days at 32-35 degrees centigrade. Secondly, the existence of mosquitoes in new areas is increasing due to global warming, and it will increase the epidemic potential by 31-47% for dengue and 12-27% for malaria transmission. Although studies linking climatic factors to dengue are limited, it is generally accepted that changes in precipitation, ambient temperature and humidity may influence the abundance and distribution of the mosquito vectors. Several studies have shown a positive relationship between rainfall and dengue. The timing of rainfall is as important as the amount of rain. Warmer temperatures can increase transmission potential by allowing the mosquito vector to survive and reach maturity much faster and shorten the virus incubation period. The Malaysian government has taken steps in mitigation and effective mechanisms through multi-agency interventions, which includes strengthening already existing programs within the Ministry of Health to address climate-sensitive issues and health-related issues, such as vector-borne and water-borne diseases. Priority has also been given to sanitary waste disposal and provision of clean water in these challenging times. High priority is given to research and development to address these forthcoming challenges. Malaysia has also prepared a plan of action for drought to face uncertainties that may arise due to the El Nino phenomenon. At the regional level, Malaysia hosted and participated in the regional forum on environment and health for Southeast Asia and East Asian countries, and was appointed as the chair for 2014 to 2016. In this forum, climate change is one of the priorities amongst all attendees. Malaysia is a member of the Technical Working Group on Climate Change, Ozone Depletion, and Ecosystem Change. In line with the United Nations Framework on Climate Change Objectives, Malaysia has pledged to reduce carbon emission intensity of gross domestic product up to 40% by 2020 and has introduced a short-term roadmap to guide the voluntary reduction in emission intensity of GDP by up to 40% raised from 2005 levels by 2020, conditional on technology transfer and financing from developed countries. I am strongly confident that each member country has the same intention. Our commitment should be supported by strong political determinations to combat the impact of the climate change in our respective countries, and also to participate and support collectively at both regional and international levels. These efforts will not only protect our population, but also our future generations. Whilst development is essential, we should ensure that in the quest for economic development, we don't lose sight of the present and future health of our people. With those words, I thank you, Mr. Chairman.